What is the meaning of your name? Why did you choose it?
I don't think there is any meaning anymore. It's just, it was a line from a David Bowie song. But I don't think there's any meaning to it, to be honest.
Scottish bands said that in the beginning it was very difficult for them to be considered in the English record market and to catch the attention of the English audience, just because they were from Scotland. Did you have the same problem?
No, we never had that problem, and I think that was an excuse for, because it's only 400 miles from London, and you could always, you know, send a tape or hitchhike to London like we did when we made a tape. And actually we found that it could work for you, because in London there would be another, you know, million bands all trying to get a record deal. So no, we never believed in that, and I think we made it work for our advantage.
Do you need any particular conditions to find the inspiration for a new album, a new song?
I'm sure I do, but I've been writing words and such since I was a small kid, and it's hard to say why. It's just, you know, something you do. For me, it's a great way to relax, and so. But lately, I've found that I need to be back home in Scotland before I can really settle down and get take time to focus. That's why it's been such a long time since our last album. Won't you conceal by me? I'll be alone, dancing in the old baby. Tell me your troubles and doubts, giving me every bit inside and out of. Looking back at the time of your top single, Don't You Forget About Me, it's quite clear that you changed a lot during these years. Things like the look of the band, the lyrics of the songs. Can you tell me which are the reasons that have been pushing you to make this change? There's been no reasons to make the changes. It's been I'm sure you've changed in three years.
It's like growing up.
Yeah, it's an evolution of, I think it's going forward. Maybe it's going back, I don't know, but it's hard, you know, it's hard to say why this was or why that was. Our thing is still very much kind of organic. It just happens that way. It falls that way. I mean, obviously when you go on tour, there's a lot of planning, and you plan this and you plan that. But the actual songs and such is what dictates how things are going to be. And they just arrive out of nowhere.
About your last work, songs like Mandela Day, Belfast Child, Biko. Can you explain me why you decided to do something about these big problems, and which is the link between them?
Well, we wanted to, when we were making this new album, we wanted to try and write an album that had songs about people and places and these times that we are. Like most, you know, people, I think, if you're at all sort of any sensitivity, it's it infiltrates into the art and the music. So I think it was about time to try, and it's just time to understand the times that we are, you know, living in. And I think behind all of Simple Minds, you know, music for the last
4 or 5 years, there's been a spirit of life. And these are all, you know, these are songs about human beings and human, you know, conditions on a global sense. But also some of the songs are about a local sense in Scotland as well.
Last year there have been singers which decided to fight for what we can call the human rights, trying to provocate a positive reaction against the apartheid and all the wrong situation in the world with their songs, their speech, their concerts. Many rock stars are involved in this big, we can call it political business, because it is a political business, and yourself too. So do you really believe that doing something with music can change this situation? What's your opinion about it?
No, I don't think music, music alone can change these things. But I think music and art can help to kind of crystallize an opinion or a feeling that's in the air. And also, I think it's still governments and politicians who really make the changes. They have the power. But they respond to votes, and they are always watching the popular opinion, because really, that's for most of them, that's all they care about getting your vote. So, but I do think music helped. You know, in 1967 or something, I think it probably helped America come out of Vietnam and young people and such. It helps to make clear an opinion. I think art has always done that, and you know, music is one of the, you know, kind of popular art. Encourage them that what they're doing is a good idea, and always pushing for them to come up with something. For instance, you know, Charlie would play the whole day, but he would never think of recording it. And you walk in and he's playing these incredible lines. But so in some ways, I just kind of push for it to come together. And what do I give them? I probably give them, probably put it in a box for them, or try and find a way to articulate it for them. I don't think I do a very good job, but the best I can do. In the last 2 or 3 years, we've had a chance to listen to many things, but in a contemporary sense, you know, people come and give you tapes, and bands are looking for, you know, the tour and such, and you get to hear things, but it's not quite as important as it was for me to go out and look for new things. I would always have done that when I was young, always look for new things, but anything from Elvis Presley to, I don't know, just the history of music, history of rock and roll.
Last single, you have been working with Lou Reed. Are you planning to work with other rock stars?
No, that wasn't a plan. It was just something. It was for us a nice kind of thrill to call him up and ask him to sing a few lines. And it took about, you know, 30 minutes. So I would hardly say that it was a big you know, collaboration. No, I don't plan to work with other rock stars. I love working with Charlie Burchill and Michael McNeil, and that's our musical family.
American music production and the British one.
It's hard to generalize. I think in general, engineers and producers in America spend a lot more time kind of building up their reputation and studying. In Britain, you get young guys who are very quickly thrown into the limelight, and sometimes that's good because they've got all that kind of energy, but other times it's a little inexperienced. I honestly don't know. It's a hard question to answer, because there's all that heavy metal stuff comes out of America as well, and I don't know. It's not something I really think about too much.
Spend 24 hours when you're not working. Do you play any sport? Do you have any particular hobby? I know something about football,
yeah? Yeah, that's true. I find in my spare time I like to drive, because I've only passed my driving test recently. It's a big thrill. But also, I've got children, and it's important to try and see what they want to do. And that usually dictates. But we're football fans, and we have a team which is not very good. But these kind of things, you know, movies and actually television as well. The last 2 years in Britain, the television has been incredible, much better than I could remember it. So things like that. There's so many magazines and newspapers coming out as well, not to mention books. There never seems to be enough time. And I can't believe that suddenly it's time for us to go on tour again. It seemed like we could get a lot of things done, but I feel pretty excited.
Tell me something about your movie.
The video for This Is Your Land was shot a few weeks ago in Spain, a place called Almeria. And it was a little bit unfortunate, because we went there for the beautiful, you know, colors and sunshine and such, and when we arrived there it was like we had brought the weather from Scotland. Once again, that seems to happen to us. But it was directed by Andy Morahan, who did the Belfast Child video, and he's the person we've enjoyed working with the most.